weekly podcast brought to you by Open Letter and 3%, in which we take one giant book, break it down section by section, talk about it, debate it, make jokes about it, have a good time. And this season, the eighth season, we're doing Codex 1962 by Sjón, which is translated from the Icelandic by Victoria Cribb. And I am joined, as always, with Brian Wood.
Hi, Chad. It's wonderful to be here. I'm a little tired today. I imagine you're tired.
I actually feel pretty good. Really? I'm a little tired. I've been up since 4:15.
Oh, wow. But all right.
Otherwise, I'm okay. I was on the train all the way home, all the way down here. I slept a little bit, read this section that we're going over today, and then got ready to do this.
Yeah. I had this terrible idea of like, hey, I should exercise so I could have some energy this summer. And so I started that today, and that was a bad idea. I'm terrible at exercising and moving around, and that's all exercise kind of is.
Yep, that is true.
Kind of sucks like that. So
I love it. Yes, yesterday morning I ran like 7 miles, but I'd run like 6 miles the night before. So it was like 13 miles over like a 12-hour period, and I like my hip hurts. Like I can barely move my left hip right now. Like it was a dumb thing to do.
Yeah, yeah, that's kind of my yearly quota, about 13 miles. Yeah. I'm good for the year.
Do it all at once, I'm good.
I got that all knocked out.
So today we're going over the second volume of Sjón's book. This one's called Iceland's Thousand Years. We're going over pages 198 through 256, which is essentially chapters 2 through 7. But before we get started, do you have any general thoughts or comments from last time? Last time we broke into this section and like analyzed that first chapter where it was paralleling the first chapter of the first volume, and it sort of left off. So we didn't have anything about what the second part really is. But now that you've read some of it, like what's your thought?
Well, so far from the brief bit of it that I've read, it kind of feels like a series of myths and histories of like, but on a more personal level. Because like the first one starts off like overarching of like, this is how this town got to be named Kukenstand, or you know, or whatever it's called. It's kind of like bigger and, you know, like sweeping like more time and more distance. Then it kind of gets tighter and tighter and tighter, but it feels like there's like these different types of myths.
Is this one? Yeah, the different types of myths is, yeah, for sure. We'll get to a couple. There's like at least two stories in here, I think, that are like the interjection stories. But they also, to me, work me as being more nation building,
mm-hmm.
Versus like the first one being like the myth of Gabriel and the apocalypse and you know that big heavy stuff. And this one is like more Iceland, like very specifically the creation of Iceland.
Yeah, even to the point where like it's about two people getting their. Is it their citizenship, or I'm trying to remember exactly.
That's a fun part.
Yes, I mean, it's just like, what does it even mean? What does it even mean to be Icelandic, or you know?
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of good stuff in this section. Actually, this is where I think this book really gets into another gear right here. Yeah, you're reading this on the screen, I'm like, yes, this is what I love about this book. I read the tone, the sort of like way that it's creating, like. Because this section too is Iceland's Thousand Years, and it's subtitled a crime story. And we get a bit of the crime. We see a little bit more of these machinations of plotting going on here in this first bit, which is fun compared to the first volume that was a little bit more like straightforward. There wasn't a lot of like interweaving of ideas. It was the invalid, the Jews there in bed, the woman's going to take care of him. There's going to be a baby, even though that turns out to be a golem. It's not like there's a lot of like moving pieces, and this has a few more moving pieces to it. It seems like.
Yeah. No, and it came at a perfect time because I think I had just got in a conversation with, well, I shouldn't say conversation, a group text. Aren't those the best? When you're like trying to go to sleep and someone decides to reply all at like 3 a.m. or whatever.
Oh yeah, yeah, I've done that.
With my family, they're all out on the Pacific time zone, but they're big Warriors fans, except for my brother-in-law, who just likes whatever is going against what my parents like. So, and then my dad was like, well, it's un-American to root for Toronto. And then I go like, well, technically, like, that's still North America, right? So like, it's American.
Yeah.
So then it was like, well, then what is an American? And then that went on like, oh good, that's like 9 days worth of texting and emojis and crap. So
Oh my God.
I like this idea of like what is it to be someone from, like, is it being born there? Is it having citizenship? Is it like, what does it actually mean? Like, you know, it's a weird question. It's a weird thing to try to figure out.
Yeah. I really like how this section two moves ahead in time in an interesting way.
Yeah.
Let's start with like the first part that we went over last week was part one was, the timing. So everyone has like a little subtitle. It's like the date that it takes place. And this one's in the beginning and tells that whole history of becoming Iceland and the chick that escapes all that stuff. But we're going to start today is like the second part of this. Part two takes place on June 17th, 1944, which right off the bat, do you know what June 17th, 1944 was?
Is that D-Day?
No, I don't know. It was not.
Well, that's a dumb guess then. Shame on me.
Really? Like, no. That was in 45, I believe, right?
I don't know.
Probably it's 45. Okay.
I'm not good with
that. Everyone erase that part of your memory. This date is very specific. It's Iceland's independence from Denmark. It's the day they declare independence from Denmark.
Oh, that's why they're making fun of Danes in here. Okay, got it.
Yeah, just Dane making fun of part, I really want to get into and throw some shade. But like,
I don't know what a bacon eater is, but like, I'm down to be one of them.
That's the stuff. Wait till we get there, because I have a lot of questions.
Okay, all right.
But in this part, so this section starts off. It's on the Godafoss, which is, if you remember, the boat that.
June 6th, 1944 is D-Day. Come on, I wasn't that far
off. June 6th, yeah, so a week.
I should have known. 2 weeks. I mean,
Mondays.
Yeah. I watched Saving Private Ryan once, so I should have known that.
Movie sucks. That's un-American to say. But I don't like that movie at all. So he's on the Godafoss, which is the ship that he took out of Germany, and they're going north. It's a lot of, like, waves, ocean, crashing, not feeling so well about that, getting sick. And then there's like an interlude that tells the story of Tubal's Ark.
That's a weird one.
Is that, I'll summarize this because it's kind of fun, is that Tubal was like the only boy in this family of, like, back in, you know, Old Testament times where people lived till they were 800, 900 years old. He's like 140 or something at the time that this takes place. And he's the youngest child of this family. And like a little bit off, when he's got seven sisters, and they're always forced to take care of him when their parents go out, when their parents are away. And the seven sisters are like, well, this is bullshit, because now we don't get to go bang the angels and like have sex with the angels that walk among us. And so they're like, you know what we could do is we'll just dress him up as a girl and take him with us. So they go to this like base where the angels pick out the sisters they want. And then there's one, Elias, who gets Tubal, and eventually finds out that he's not, I don't remember how this part worked. I read this at 5:15 in the morning, but he, at the end, they have a relationship, like a homosexual relationship from how it's described. And then Elias, the angel, disappears. And all of a sudden there's like the huge storms, like the Noah's Ark storms, and Tubal is stuck in this tree. He floats above the water crying the whole time as like everything's washed away. And like, seems to be like Noah's Ark. And then when everything sort of dries up, he finds that the angel Elias had been holding his tree aloft so that he stayed above the water, sacrificing himself as an angel along with everything else on earth so that Tubal could live. So that's basically that. Then he gives birth. Oh yeah. He's also like somehow pregnant. He gives birth to trolls. That's part of it too.
Well, duh, if you have sex with an angel and end up covered in feathers inside of a nest, you're gonna have to have some troll babies.
Gotta have troll babies.
Jeez. Don't you know anything?
This isn't, Tubal's not a real character, real story, right?
I have no idea.
I never heard of it, but it seemed to me like an interesting, like, if it is, I don't even know. It's like something that eludes the normal Noah's Ark-ness of things. If Noah's Ark is like there's a pair of male and female of every species, this is not that, and it sort of subverts that myth in a cool way and has like this love between Elias and the Tubal, which sort of makes sense to me.
It's like a chain of islands and water areas, archipelagic.
Archipelagos?
Yeah. Like all of those have a flood narrative of some kind.
Oh yeah.
Right. And a lot of them have a lot of similarities too, with sending out doves or ravens to look for dry land, that sort of thing. So, I mean, it still has a lot of the tropes that are that connect a lot of flood narratives, and there's people that get their like PhDs in this crap that can totally correct me and say this better, but it did remind me that like it fits within a lot of that as well, while still like going all crazy in its own way. But
yeah, and like sort of
like the popular ones like Noah and Gilgamesh, right? Obviously, right. But I know like as you get north, they also have them up there as well. So
this reminded me too of like the beginning part or back in the first section where he's like, I want to have a boy that can grow up and be and love peace and not.
A different man.
A different man from the rest, a peace-loving boy who'll grow up to be a good man. Like something about this, that reminded me of this, where it's like sort of an origin, another origin myth with him being the seemingly one of the only survivors of this as like a different type of person, different type of male.
Yeah. And I don't know the timing necessarily on this one, obviously, because it's like, hey, you're 160 years old now. You're old enough. Like, well, okay, this is weird. But I did find it interesting that with the other one, it's time to have a new person coming out of the horrors of, you know, a world war or the, you know, the start of a world war.
Right. Right. Exactly.
And if you think about it with a flood narrative, a lot of them, at least in the biblical ones, it's God wanting to hit the reset button because of man's wickedness.
Yeah.
Right. Like, well, this all went to hell. Let's try again. Reset. Right. So
it's sort of like when I play video games.
Yeah. Yeah.
Constantly.
So I think it fits with that as well. Right. Like,
yeah. Yeah. A new start, a new idea, a new possibility, a new nation with Iceland too.
I like it.
Makes sense. So then we get like this little bit here, which is interesting, Coda, of the narrator talking to the woman who just came.
Wait, why didn't you sing the song on 208? I wanted to hear how that goes.
I couldn't figure this one out at all. I have a different song though. But I have no idea how you're supposed to sing this one. Which means God is Lord. The Sail Away singer. You remember that?
Come Sail Away Sticks?
No. it was a woman. There is maybe that.
Christopher Cross.
Enya.
Takes me away. Is that the one?
Yeah, I'm thinking of Enya. An Enya song, an Enya background with like her singing this.
I went with Spaghetti Western, Good, Bad, and the Ugly, or Christopher Cross. That's definitely how you're supposed to.
That's how you're supposed to hear it.
As a musician, we'll definitely have to ask him this one, and we'll sing for him when he's on.
for anyone not watching this on YouTube, or maybe just listening to the podcast, it might look like I'm sitting inside of the bathroom, but this is just my hotel room. The sink is outside of the actual bathroom, which is closed behind me and looks like a private detective's door. Like this is the most beast hotel I've ever stayed in, but I'm seeing it now and hearing me like, man, this must look real weird. Like I'm just hanging out in the bathroom doing a podcast.
So speaking of, are you there for the unveiling of the Translated Book Award finals
tomorrow afternoon?
Ah, if you were a betting man, who would you bet on?
We talked about this on the 3% podcast, and I think. Tom thinks that Orfeu, the other Icelandic book that is on the short list by Ulfrigur Sigurdsson, that he thinks that will win. And Litton translated that, so that would be very cool.
Oh, that'd be sweet.
That'd be great. I have a feeling it's going to be this Patrick Chamisseau book, Slave Old Man, but I don't know. I don't have any reason why. I just have a gut feeling. But I don't know. It seems like there's like four books that it could be.
I'm going to go with The Governess.
That's too sexy.
I haven't even read it. I don't even know what it is.
Too sexy.
Okay. I just heard people like it. So I'll go.
I like it a lot. It's very good, but it's very sexy. It's like out. Yes. It might not have like, it doesn't have like really a weight to it,
which sure.
I don't think it'll win. It doesn't have, it's not, it's very fun and very like whatever, but it's very sensual sort of book that doesn't necessarily have a like, you know, meaning or punch or like literary explosion to it.
And just another quick side, like having met her, I'd love for Dubrovka to win, but also, I'd really like Emma's book to win, just having met her and Tom and their bookstore and stuff. It'd be awesome for them.
Yeah, that would be cool too. I don't know that Letter could win 3 years in a row.
Yeah.
But Dubravka's book is amazing, so.
I would call shenanigans if that happens. There's something, we need to have an investigative body.
You guys, yeah,
there's some collusion going on. There's something, I want to see tax records.
I know from Twitter that they decided on a winner because someone said that they submitted a quote for the press release, but I have literally no idea on either of them.
Cool. Well,
good. Which is, it'll make it really exciting tomorrow afternoon.
Can't wait to find out.
Same.
So but it wasn't Codex 1962, which is surprising.
Which, yeah, I thought was going to win. I was willing to put money on that one.
Is that what your class picked?
They picked this, and they picked Pretty Things.
Hey, there you go. Okay.
Those were the two that were, like, up there. Okay. There was a third one, too, Come a Madre, but it was, like, a step below. But those are the two that they were really into. So, yeah, and most of them, it was interesting because I think that the third volume of this book is where things get real crazy. But a lot of them thought that this section that we're reading is the best part of the trilogy. So we'll see.
So then after the flood narrative,
move on to the third.
Is that where we get like a black history from like a suburb of Atlanta?
Yeah. So there's the dad whose name I'm blanking out on.
They're like black Pentecostals.
Is it Leo? Leomo?
Where is it?
I think it's Leo.
Takes place around 210-ish.
Yeah. So he's sick from all of the bad, you know, up and down, blah, 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 and he's getting sick. One thing I want to point out though is that so then there's a knock on the door. There's a guy, this black guy, that's hiding inside of his cabin. The door opens and there's two people there, and they're like obviously looking for this black guy that's hiding behind the door. But this is an important line where it's mentioned that these are the men who had hauled them aboard. They had taken a gold ring from him, broken it in half, and split it between them. Because that's going to come up again in a little bit.
Yeah. Because that was when we were like, when he got on the boat, like, what the hell is going on with this boat? Like, the descriptions were got all, like, carnival-esque and weird and, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I believe that's the ring that was put into the golem baby to bring it to life.
Yeah.
Now that ring has been split in half and is with these two other people, which explains a chapter that's coming up.
Okay.
Good to know. So then we get, yeah. So then the visitor, whose name is Anthony Brown, says that he tells the whole story of how he was from Dream On, a nameless suburb of Atlanta, and how he ended up getting on this boat, or how he ended up being here, was that he had been gotten a fight with these kids, and he was buying pork rinds, and then he saw that there was an elderly man on the sidewalk who was dressed so fancy they thought he'd get punished, but that ended up being his benefactor. They don't really get into like any more of that story here. Instead, they're like interrupted where with one of my favorite lines, Anthony Brown fell silent and waited for my father to react to the story, but he had fallen asleep, so he didn't understand a word of English.
Yeah.
Oh, that's like a side thing. And then it has they go to a party, and this is where it has the handwritten slogan 17 June 1944, which is the day that Iceland declared independence from Denmark, which is what this whole party is for, I assume. And which is why on the next page, they sing the Icelandic national anthem, which this again, I'm not going to sing it, but what's interesting is when I looked it up to see if this was actually the anthem, the national anthem, the Wikipedia page for it, for like Lofsanger, something like that, is the name of the national anthem. In Icelandic, they have an Icelandic, a phonetic transcription, which is nonsense. And then in English, and the English one is slightly different than this in an interesting way. Like it sounds like it was run through maybe Google Translate. It came out kind of fun. So listen to this. O God of our land, O our country's God, we praise your holy, holy name. From the solar systems, we will tie you a crown. Your army is a timely collection. That's the part that I thought was weird. So this says, thy crown is woven from the sons of heaven by the legions, the ages of time. Whereas this one is, from the solar systems, we will tie you a crown.
Yeah, so wouldn't you call it the heavens? Line. Like, why would you use solar systems? It's like all scientific versus celestial.
Yeah, they'll tie you a crown of what? Yeah. Stars?
that's like one of those ones in translation workshop, like maybe you should go with like the heavens here, yeah, or the skies, or you know, the firmament.
There's some other one that like, and then it's a, oh no, it's got the Iceland's thousand years, and then an eternal flower with a tear in its eye that praises its god and then dies.
It's like emo, very emo.
Yeah, it's like fucking Panic at the Disco over here.
Yeah.
Iceland's national anthem.
I like that it has all the A's in there, and then it explains where the A might come from.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
All right.
There is, so that they sing their, there's a national anthem's going on. They're all on this ship.
Which, wait, have you ever asked why Canadians do the A?
I don't know why they do it.
Okay.
I thought it was just because they spoke funny. Like, and it was just habit.
It's because they got stupid basketball teams that aren't going to win. That's why, A.
According to 538, they got a 43% chance of winning, which is more than Donald Trump had.
That's a lot of chances, actually.
That is very high. They think that it's the people are like, I think their projection system's off. Like, I think we're gonna have this right, but I think they've got like a 12% chance personally.
I wouldn't surprise me if they won.
It would surprise me. If they won more than two games, I'll be surprised.
Okay.
I don't believe in anyone except for Golden State. Anyway, so they then like his father passes out, whatever. And they're on their way to Iceland. And then there's this weird little bit where our narrator is imagining essentially a ship's dog called Sirius and has like this kind of like little story, like adventure story that he imagines for himself. Cause it's Yosef, and that's his name, Yosef Lowe. And so it has this story of them being on the ship and sailing off. And it ends with like a new day is dawn in the life of the little sailor and his dog. Beyond the far horizon, exciting adventures will await them. And then reads off these like five descriptions that are essentially like books about their adventures that he and his dog have. And the thing about this is I don't think this is possible because this came out in 2001. So this reminds me a lot of the Against the Day of the Thomas Pynchon book. There's this recurring characters that are called the Chums of Chance, who are both like in the world, but also are stars of the series of adventure books for boys. And they're always like Chums of Chance battle, like the minions of hell or the Chums of Chance through the Arctic narrative. And it's, they're all described sort of like this, like those kind of, it's using that same trope of those boys' life adventures and that side of sort of thing. But I thought it was kind of a fun little thing that seems in common of like a little talking point between both authors.
And there is the kind of like the gamesmanship, you know, like that kind of playfulness where the last book number five in the series is the Tasmanian werewolf. And then there's that question of like, what does a werewolf eat? He's like, people, I thought. And you're like, no, you idiot. You don't know what werewolves eat. What's wrong with you?
Werewolves do eat people, right?
I thought so. I don't know.
Maybe they eat chickens.
I'm not big on the Lycian. Is that what they're called? Lycian?
Yep.
I'm not really big on like, who invented the werewolf myths? Is that like French or something?
Probably.
I don't know.
Probably Swiss.
I just know they like glitter when they're in love or something. There's glitter on their skin. And then, I don't know, it's Twilight.
Oh my God.
That's the vampire.
That's a werewolf, doesn't it?
I did like this book, The Cold Room. Yosef and Sirius get wind of a plot by a former officer of the Third Reich to bring Europe to its knees again. Did the Allies ever find the Nazis' infamous machine of world destruction? What is the Cold Room? Where is it? And what secret does it hold? A terrifically exciting book by the author of Light in the Depths.
This is like our jacket copy that we wrote.
Yeah, I know. I forgot I'll have to do that for this one.
But this one too, this one is the one that reminded me of the most of the Pynchon book, because the Pynchon book also deals a lot with Tesla and his cannon that he was making that would be like the world's or the greatest weapon.
Yeah.
World destruction. That, you know, theoretically might have caused the tungsten event in Siberia. Which I believe. I totally believe.
I'm curious about this last one, though, the Tasmanian werewolf. What is Yosef to believe when a peaceful group of Aborigines from Tasmania ask for his help in defeating a werewolf? Is it a case of primitive superstition? Or does the nearby atomic power station have a dark secret to hide? The fifth book about the companions of Joseph and Sirius will surprise even their most devoted fans. Now, I'm curious if there's going to be some parallels between people that belong and then like new people that are coming in.
Yeah.
Type of situation, especially with what is it to be Icelandic was kind of hinted at here a little bit afterwards. And there's another, the werewolf callback. So I'm kind of curious if maybe there's some sort of like key in some of these fun little books.
That you know, this is the section that seems to me the most reminiscent of a Thomas Jansen bestseller, which he did many, many, many seasons ago, where he's got like a lot of playful things that sort of like jump on top of one another and it switches form real quick. Like this kind of like fun little bit reminds me a bit of that, where it's like, because it even changes in tone. Like that Tasmanian werewolf one seems much more like horrifying, as does the cold room, than like the light in the depths, where it's like, Joseph and his dog managed to find the U-boat lair and prevent the Nazi attack. Who's the one-eyed man who steals from house to house under cover of night?
Yeah.
It's like very instant. Then these become darker or more crazy. Are aliens?
Yeah. I mean, this is a more, obviously it's a more innocent version of like Bloodfoot or something, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Cause like, even that's like some ridiculous, like he lays in wait in the park. And when the mom leaves, he just runs by and steps on a baby's head. Like,
yeah,
what the hell? Dressed as a priest or something, like, right. It's like some weird pulpy, like murder book. It's weird. And these are like, you know, like 10-10, like what's 10-10 going to do? He's going to find a pharaoh and the lost pharaoh, or, you know, something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
But even then, like this last paragraph here after that fifth one, I miss you, Sirius, my imaginary canine friend, and have never missed you more than now when I must leave you and continue my father's story.
Yeah, it's interesting.
But my tale will probably suffer the same fate as the boy's own stories. So I think there is something in these, right?
Oh, yeah. When the war was no longer on everybody's lips and the entrance of the average Western boy turned to other kinds of dangers and villains, the authors were forced to bow to the times and the inclinations of their readers. Like that sort of like, it's, yeah, I like that. Like that innocent, or that time where that was the mode.
Yeah, I don't like to throw the word meta around because it makes me feel like I'm back in grad school again. But like, there's different layers of the text that are kind of playing with each other and with us, I think. And
yeah,
this is just another introduction of it for sure.
Yeah, and what makes one of those kind of books is kind of interesting.
So meta.
So part three is set the one day later on June 18th, 1944. And it opens with like a misdirect because it Also not D-Day, but close to D-Day. The smell of porridge spreads throughout the house, wafting as usual to the nose of the boy who's sleeping in the closet in the attic. And I immediately feel like that was supposed to feel like that could be him, like the boy. Mm-hmm. But then it has his sister. And then we find out that this is not our narrator at all. It's a whole new character, a whole new setting.
It's Harry Potter, right?
It's Harry Potter.
Yeah.
He's got a wand. His wand or stamps.
In the attic. Yeah.
Living in the attic. I'm sure Harry Potter lived in an attic. He lived under lived in the basement, right? Under the staircase.
I think it's loosely based off of the book The People Under the Stairs. There is a connection between those two.
Exactly. I thought Harry Potter lived in a train.
No, I'm the worst person to ask because I've never read Harry Potter and I haven't seen any of them, so I don't know.
Things that I don't know about.
I know nothing.
Like Harry Potter, 50 Shades of Grey, Game of Thrones.
How are you breathing?
I have no idea. I don't know any of these things.
How are you breathing?
And the most I know about Harry Potter is because every student in my class read every one of those books. You know, it was like their generation that was reading that. So they're always like, they'll reference things like, I have no idea.
I had a student ask me once, how can you teach a class on writing if you haven't read Harry Potter? I'm like, I don't know. I've read other stuff, I guess.
Doesn't count, man. Does not count. Yeah. But this one, so this has a little bit about this boy whose name is I'm going to mispronounce it, but Asker.
Yeah, that sounds about right. I think you nailed it.
Yep,
nailed it.
His dad has some issues, some anger issues for them, and everyone's celebrating that they're becoming an independent nation. But he's sort of upset because he's not going to be part of the they're doing like a sort of reenactment of the new code of arms for Iceland. And he's not going to be part of it. And he's sort of annoyed by that, and he's running around doing things. He smashes with his stick, he brandishes, he takes his oaken staff, and he brandishes over his head, smashing the light fitting above the table. Fragments of glass rain down on father and son, which automatically, even though it has nothing to do with it, reminds me of the scene from Ulysses in the whorehouse, because when Stephen breaks the light. And then we get another, the old man and the mirror, which we'll get into in a second, because that one's pretty fun. But then they ends like that he's going to be going, so Asker is going to go to his water swimming club thing. He's got some sort of issues as well. He's going to come up in a little bit again, but this is like his real introduction, where it seems like his dad is sort of violent, dangerous, aggressive, antagonistic, demanding, and that Asker is a little bit off. He does reference like losing part of his finger in this, doesn't he?
Yeah, he like sprays a bunch of blood over his grandma and sprays other stuff on her, like, and that's how it's born.
Also, like, I thought there's a part where he's like, he hasn't had any problems since he like lost a piece of his finger.
Yeah, she clips it.
Yeah,
I recall.
So the story that's in the middle, the old man and the mare, is the story supposedly of Asiger's grandfather, in which he was trying to put a horseshoe on a, like a really, I don't know what you call it, like agitated, excitable mare who kicks back at him and hits him in the forehead and leaves the nail that he was trying to use in the horseshoe in his forehead. The guy survives, and everyone's trying to pull it out and can't get the nail out of his forehead. So he's just like lying there, you know, the nail on his forehead. And there's a young woman who's supposed to take care of him. So similar to our Leo Low story and Marie Sophie from the first part, where there's an invalid that this young woman is taking care of. So the young girl is supposed to like give him water, make him, you know, keep him whatever.
The horseshoe now made your grandfather so thirsty he drank unceasingly.
Yeah, I love that.
If your grandmother brought it. It's like the idea of like the way, you know, the kids these days say thirsty.
Yeah.
Yeah. That horse nail in the head made your grandpa pretty thirsty. And when your grandma came around, look out. That's how your old dad was born.
It's such a great line too, to fitting right in with that. So it's like one night, yeah, deciding she had enough of caring or carting way to your granddad, she sees the pliers that lay on the chest by his bed. Straddling the old man, she gripped the nail with the pliers, and after an interval of rocking, the blood gushed into the air like a geyser right in your grandmother's face. You can guess what happened next. It was not the only thing to gush out of the old man.
Gross, Dad.
That's how your father was
conceived. Yeah, I mean, it's like total nonsense. It's like this crazy nonsense, like, I don't know, just like barbarian story, right? Of just like horse kicks me in the face. We're just like rocking all on top of me, pulls a nail out of my head, and then you're pregnant.
Pregnant.
That's like, oh, yes. Born. And that's how our nation was born.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's just as crazy. Like, I don't know. In some ways, it can sound just as crazy. Like, if somebody wants to really believe and retell the story of, like, so God gathered all this dirt and he, like, breathed into it. And then this guy shows up, names everything, and then takes a rib out, and that's his wife. And then they have babies.
Yeah.
And then here we are. Like, oh, okay, that's legit. Works for me.
I found the part that I was thinking of. So it's the very last paragraph on 226. He also knows that he stopped wetting his bed the day he cut off the tip of the middle finger with his on his right hand, the very day that he, Asker, the son of Helgi, the son of Steingrimmer, was due to begin training at the Poseidon Swimming Club. There's a lot of water in this whole section so far. Like, they had the boat, but this water thing, the swimming thing. And that was true with the book, the Icelandic book, the Thomas Jansson as well, that there's a lot of stuff about water because it's island nation. Water is very like vital to this. It both separates them and connects them. Like all those kind of things that play out. That's also what I think reminds me of that book in this little bit.
Yeah, it's those, like, I'll mispronounce again, those archipelagic narratives. Yeah, man, it's all about the water, baby.
Oh, water. How about the fluid?
Blood and water.
Yep. That's pretty much that's obviously what came out of the grandfather. Water. The blood, the water, the wine. So I don't have anything else with that section. Then we go into part four, which jumps ahead 14 years. So now it's March 11th, 1958, which I didn't look up that date.
Here, talk. I'll look it up.
Okay, you look it up.
I don't think it's D-Day, but it might be something like that. We'll see.
Adam Baum was dropped.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding. It said blew a hole in rural Mars Bluff, South Carolina. It was an atomic bomb, and on March 11, 1958, it created the only tourist accessible site in the U.S. accidentally cratered by a nuclear weapon.
Oh, okay.
What the fuck? I wonder if that's what this is supposed to... I mean, the bombs have shown up a bunch of times. Hmm. Or the, earlier, the atomic stuff.
Yeah.
Part of this.
Nuclear weapon loss incident. Mars Bluff.
Yeah, Mars Bluff is a great name. Mars Bluff, South Carolina. That feels like like very appropriate, and I'm curious about what kind of people live in Mars Bluff.
Yeah, that's the only thing that shows up on here.
Yeah, same thing for me. So, okay, so, oh, okay. Interesting. We're not, we don't get through this whole section, so I don't even know if there's anything that, that can really tie back into it for this one. But anyway, so it begins. This is the story of his dad, Leopold Loeb, and sort of setting up his current situation. So he's been in Iceland for a number of years now. He wakes up there. He's at the beginning, he's dreaming. He has a goat that's like bashing in his window and trying to eat all the shit. And Loeb is sleeping and having this dream that there's an exhibition called Faces of Iceland. That's pictures of like basically everyone in Iceland, all arranged by where they live in the country, that this photographer and anthropologist had put together. And it feels like, not, I don't, I assume this is a dream based on the line later on, but it also seems like that could be a project. Like I could see that being a real thing pretty easily. Mm-hmm. They open it up, and then the big joke is that when Leo goes to find his photo, they're all laughing at it and pointing because it's just a picture of a big toe. It's his face.
You are what you see.
You are what you see. Leo Lowe, overseer. Like, I was wondering if that's a joke on like overseer, or like overseeing, like seeing too much, or like mm-hmm. paying too close attention to certain details. Not entirely sure, but like, yeah. So then he wakes up, he shakes off both anthropologists and sleep, which I assume makes it a dream. There's a little bit about his goat and his situation with that. But the most important thing is that, that they at one point in time where he tells a story about how he found the goat, but he was with this guy, Peter Salmonson Hoffman, who finds like a ring, a gold ring. And he's like, Leo, is this your ring? And he's like, no, it wasn't the right ring. Leo's ring was still in the hands of the robbers, split in two. Peter said he would continue to keep an eye out for it, though he didn't understand what was so special about it. Gold was gold. Then you get to see that there is a, he's doing alchemy in his like room, that is in this section, right? Yeah, where the hat box with the baby is, he washes the baby, our narrator, who's still a golem at this point. He doesn't have, he's been making gold to be able to reanimate our narrator, but he hasn't made enough gold yet to do that because he needs these, this gold ring that would, had been broken in half by the two robbers on the boat.
Yeah, makes sense to me.
Yeah, so, yep. So just the, as a mechanism though, it's going to make sense because it's going to set the plot in motion. So even if it's like the MacGuffin of sort, or it's not really a MacGuffin because it is an important part of it, but like it is a thing that just sets an emotion as we'll see as this kind of unwinds, but that Leo's main motivation at this point in time is to get that ring so that he can bring his golem to life.
Correct, yeah.
His son. I thought this was a pretty fun way to introduce him too. Like he feels like an old sort of like off, like off kilter dude in this house with a freaking goat.
Yeah.
Love it. Goofy, goofy. Then we get the one about his citizenship, which you talked about. So this chapter is like probably the most complicated one. Is this the right one? No, it's the next one. It's like the more wild one. But this one is the where he decides, he goes to the Ministry of Justice to fill out and apply for citizenship. And this is where
here's how it ends. The ending of 235 is a great setup. There, old chap. Daddy will be home by supper time, and then we'll be Icelanders, you and I. He turns around in the pantry doorway. Icelanders, Josie, imagine. Right? So it's like, oh, okay. Like, lead us right into the...
They're going to be Icelanders now.
Yeah.
And this is where this in the next chapter have a really intricate plotting device that is obvious and it's easy to put together, but it is like where this ring mechanism will work. And I found this really well done. But basically it starts out here where he goes to the Ministry of Justice, says, I'm going to apply for citizenship. Like, do you speak Icelandic? And boom, you get this digression about how for years he had been working when he first worked there. This is where you get the Danish stuff that they're making fun of, which I'll come back to in a second. But that he... ends up taking all these lessons to learn Icelandic with this guy, Mikhail Pushkin, which is a wonderful name, who's a Russian embassy employee, in other words, working for the KGB. And they go to learn Icelandic. And here's the water thing again, where before every Icelandic lesson, because they're not Icelandic, the Iceland teacher is like, you must drink Icelandic water because Icelandic water will help make you, you know, make you better, more Icelandic. So they've got the water thing there. They learn the language sort of, but the main bit of this is that Pushkin is like, dude, what do you call the teacher is talking about how Iceland has words for everything. They have different words for like a cat's tail versus a mouse tail versus a, you know, a lizard tail versus whatever type of tail, fish tail. All these have different words, and that's why Icelandic is so infinite and wonderful and glorious and like detailed. And so then Pushkin's like, do you have a word for this? Like, it's kind of crazy. I should have that. Starts pulling his pants down and like, oh no. But it turns out he's got a tail,
which, yeah, telltale,
call a rear projection.
That's funny, Adam. And I didn't want to read into it, but do you think he's trying to play with like poetry and isn't Pushkin a poet?
Pushkin's a poet.
Russian poet, I think.
Yeah. Alexander Pushkin. I think he is playing with that and with like just a typical Russian person. Yeah. But so he's got his tail, which is fun and funny. And then it ends with that bit that you mentioned earlier where the guy's on the phone, Leo's like thinking back and answering that question. Yes, I can speak Icelandic, but what does it mean to be Icelandic? Is it just speaking the language or is it more? Is it the water? Is it the spirit? Is it the soul? And this kind of reflects back to that dream that he has of like the faces that are of Iceland and how Iceland, the environment and the weather and the nature and landscape of Iceland is reflected in the faces of its people who reflect the soul of Iceland. And these two things are working off one another. So he's sort of thinking back as to whether he really is Icelandic. Says, yes, I can speak Icelandic. They're like, cool, good to hear. And then the guy picks up the phone. Something crazy is said to him. And he says, what do werewolves eat? Leo didn't realize the official expected him to answer. What do they eat? The official whispered. Leo whispered back, people. Aren't they man-eaters? The official shook his head, astonished at the foreigner's ignorance, then continued the telephone conversation. Which I think I know where that's going to go. But this chapter was one of the ones I thought was great, especially because of that bit. It's using voices for characters, which is really dangerous to do as a translation. And I'm not going to imitate this one either. But there's a 237 that we referred to where the Danish, they're all doing construction. And there's a Dane. And the Dane says, good morning, or good morn. And nobody can understand or nobody replies to them. And finally, they're like, say good morning back to the Dane. And they're the bacon eater. I want to know why. How is bacon eater an insult?
I don't know.
What does it mean?
Like, it'd be somebody like a super strict, like, Muslim or Jewish person that doesn't eat, like, pork would call somebody a bacon eater, maybe. But, like,
I don't think Danes.
But if you're both people that eat pigs, I assume both eat pigs. Like, what's the big deal about, like, hell yeah, I eat bacon. It's smoky and delicious.
Yeah. Bacon eater.
Goes great on everything.
You put bacon in it. Yeah, literally.
I didn't realize there was, like, this anti-Dane sentiment. Like, the Danes were considered especially ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like,
Okay. So I know a little bit about this from having just been in Norway too. So Norway was also ruled by Denmark and then declared their independence. And also were ruled by Sweden. I believe they're both. I'm almost positive. I'm whatever, gives a shit. Anyways, I was asking them about like who they make fun of, since everyone has to make fun of everyone else, right? Like you make fun of Canadians, like whatever. And so Norwegians always make fun of Swedish because Swedish are like their big brother that they have to make fun of. And then as a secondary one, they all make fun of the Danes. And one of the things that I know that the other parts of the Nordic world make fun of the Danes about is that nobody can understand their language when they speak. And even when I was on this trip, there's someone who's like new Swedish and Norwegian, and Swedish, Norwegian, and Danish are all basically the same. They're very, very similar. If you can read one, you can generally read the others. But she was like, I can't understand when I listen to Danish radio, I can't understand a word they're saying. Like their pronunciation is so like different and so different that she literally can't understand it, even though the words are the same as the words of the language that she can speak.
It's like when you watch Swamp People and they're speaking English, but you have to have subtitles because this person's not speaking English at all. Oh yeah, they are.
Yeah, it's exactly like that. So apparently Danish are swamp people?
Exactly.
Exactly. I think that's it.
Archipelago or whatever. Yeah. It's all about water, baby. Yeah.
And there's another thing where there's an Icelandic convention once where they're talking to about how in Iceland they wanted, like, they're having the problem of, like, the because of phones and of Siri and Fortnite and all these things, that kids don't speak Icelandic anymore. They all speak English to each other that are growing up because Siri recognizes English. Everyone's on Fortnite and they're all speaking English. So, like, they were concerned that, like, their language is sort of not going to go away, but, like, not being used by, like, the kids. And so they talked to, like, Microsoft and Apple and were like, could you make it so that, like, Siri would be able to speak Icelandic and recognize Icelandic? And they're like, we could do that. We need a lot of things. But, you know, you can do it. They're like, we could do any language except for Danish. Danish does not work.
Those bacon eaters. Yeah.
Bacon eaters. My new insult to whomever.
Gosh, it's probably like the most vile, racist thing ever. We're just making like, yeah, bacon eater, bacon eater, bacon eater. Like, damn, like this whole thing's going to go on fire because of like, oh.
We're just getting lit up.
I had no idea. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
If someone's actually watching this live and you know what bacon eaters are, like you should.
But then, tell us to stop.
Just tell us to stop.
Whoa, you cannot say that. I cannot believe you said that.
Oh, man.
Whatever. We're from America. Everybody makes fun of us right now. So
yeah, we're
the laughing stock of everything.
We are in a very shitty place.
Yeah. Let us have the bacon eater part. Come on.
Oh,
yeah, I'll look that up this week, and then we'll do all of our apologies next episode.
Yeah. So chapter 7, the last one of this, is the one that's really intricately woven and I think puts all this plot, pieces of the plot, into motion here. So the first thing that's important is that Leo's done with his interview, and he's past it. You get to figure that out later on. He goes to sit down in a cafe. And on the front page of the paper, Asker, the guy that we had met earlier as a kid, is died. They're burying him. And he was murdered. Specifically says he's murdered. So this presumably is the crime story, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe?
Yeah, we got this. We have the swimming pool. There was the mention of the Poseidon swimming club. We've got the father's stick, right? The glass shattering over them. So there's all the foreshadowing of
a werewolf might have eaten. Werewolf might have eaten him.
Or werewolves. Yeah.
So it's, and Leo's like, even Leo knew the murdered man. Asker Helgason was one of the unluckiest individuals he'd ever met. During the time Leo had been going to the swimming pool, the man had continually lost fingers and toes, even earlobes.
The hell?
Which is curious. So he reads this, the obituaries, which are written by three people. Asker's brother-in-law, and remember, he's not a kid anymore because 14 years have passed. So he's older than he was in that first scene where we saw him. But his brother-in-law, one from Hrafn Carlson, who shows up in a minute as the stamp collector, and then colleagues at the Reykjavik swimming pool. And they mentioned that he, aside from him dying, that his stamp collection has vanished. So that's another potential crime, is the stamp collection has vanished. Okay.
This is a job for a boy and his dog.
It is a job for a boy and his dog. So
right?
Going on an adventure. Who knows where the cold room is? All these things, yeah, so all tying together. So it kind of flashes back into like him going through his like his interview, and it's pretty funny because they're like, are you a communist? He's like, no, I'm an alchemist. And they're like, is that to the left or the right? And he's like, you know, it's kind of occult science.
Occult?
He's like, yeah, I know, I'm just testing you.
Oh, so you are German.
Yeah.
I'm looking for the Holy Grail so I can resurrect our forefathers to win the war. Oh, cool.
Oh, man. And then... this is the important another. So this is where all these like little loops that he's built in here. And this is another kind of pinch in thing where there's events that take place and then the explanation comes later. So everything's like cause and effect is almost reversed. So you don't see why something's happening until after it's happened. So he's getting a citizenship on this particular day. Then you get this little in bit, this little inset little bit where he's saying like, oh, you know, because he was because he was working with this stamp collector guy, Hrafn, whatever. And he's like, dude, you need to be an Icelander. You need to be an Icelander because if you're not, you'd get in a lot of trouble because you're not from here. But if you get caught doing something illegal and you're an Icelander, you only go to jail for a little while. But like, if you're not an Icelander, you'd be fucked. So this is why that specific point in time, he's going to get his citizenship because he is going to commit some sort of crime potentially, or is committing a crime. We get like a kind of, we get the zebra people thing, which I'll come back to. But in Leo's story, he then is out walking because there's like, there's a point in time where he can't sleep at night because there's this horrible smell from what they're producing at the factory. He goes out walking and runs into this guy who's like kind of shuffling away from policemen. And this guy hands him an envelope. He goes home, avoids the policeman, goes home and finds that it's a bunch of stamps. And gets a note that someone, that this person, V, has snuck in through his window saying, mate, you've got something in mind, keep it safe, more later. And then a week later gets another note saying, mate, take it to Roth and the Nazi, sell it for a good price, 10% commission. And this is then through a series of things, he finds out that Profin, the stamp collector, is the guy who would buy these stamps, and that he's a nationalist. So he's also a Nazi and is the person that he's been looking for. But the most important part is on page 256. What's more, Hrafn W. Carlson, who wrote the obituary for Afgar and earlier on in this chapter and is the stamp collector, gaped so wide that there was a gleam of teeth. Leo gasped. In the stamp dealer's left wisdom tooth, there was a flash of gold, ill-gotten gold. It was Leo's gold. He was determined to recover it by any means necessary, and to do so, he would have to keep an eye on Hrafn. So now we have another, so we have the murder of Asgar, whatever, and then this other thing where he's going to want to get that gold back because that's what he's been looking for the whole time, and it's in the stamp collector Nazi's mouth.
I'm here to get the gold.
Yeah, now we're gonna get some Ocean Bait kind of action going on.
All right,
a heist of a tooth.
Yes, I like it.
Tooth heist. But yeah, I love this chapter in particular because it weaves so many things together. Then there's a story from the zebra people, which is like about keeping people in captive until they become zebras, which I'm not entirely sure what to make of that at the moment, but I don't know that I don't have the energy to figure it out. But I love that this chapter has so many like little interweaving moments and works really well with the one before it to sort of give the motivation to Leo and to set the stage for like how he's becoming an Icelander. We still have the golem, we need the gold. There's also this murder.
Yes.
Love it. Love it. This is my favorite part.
It's finally starting to come together. Yeah.
Yeah, this for this volume. It's like moving a new thing. And we'll see how it all ties together. Did you have a favorite line from this week's one?
It wasn't like there wasn't really parts where the language like took over and there was an amazing line, but I did like the back and forth you just read where the official glared at Leo. It's on page 245. I'm from Prague. I hope you're not a communist. No, I'm apolitical. I'm an alchemist. Oh. Is that the left or the right politically speaking? You could categorize it as an occult science. Like the back and forth between it was just funny, and you know, I just enjoyed a lot of the humor that he's weaving in into the work.
Yeah,
I just realized looking at that again, we are all quote golden mouths. Hmm.
Oh yeah. Ancient
shades hold court in Kriosvik 1,000 years ago. So you have Iceland's 1,000 years. There's 1,000 years. There's gold in the mouth. There's a bunch of stuff that he's always just kind of like sprinkling throughout these narratives. So it's one of those ones like I know I'm missing so much reading it the first time, which is frustrating. So I'm just trying to take note of where to go back and look at it again. But yeah, he's doing some smart stuff with it.
Yeah, I agree. I think my favorite line has to be the one that I already read of it was not the only thing to gush out of the old man.
That's just a funny scene.
It's such a great way of putting it. Gush out. Yeah. It's so dirty and like, yes. It's
so gross.
It's really gross and like lascivious in a way. So I dig it. I love that where it's like kind of playing with those two things. It's like that old show that we remember when we watched that one terrible show, a game show that was on in the summer.
Oh God. Yeah. 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 Where you got to like defuse a bomb.
Or it just explodes.
Or it just explodes random crap on you if you get the trivia question wrong.
It was just like, oh no! And like the bomb would explode and the whipped cream would go over all the contestants.
It's one of those idiotic Fox shows when there's no, like when the terrible programming isn't working for the summer, they have to have terrible, terrible programming for 6 weeks and like, let's just put some shit in a bomb and like blow it out on people.
Yeah.
Done.
People love it. Sometimes it's like a watermelon.
Can we get a host? I have 13 people lined up. We're good.
there are so many comedians who are just waiting to host that show.
Yeah. Steve Harvey. No. Jeff Foxworth. No. Just
Who else doesn't really have a job right now?
Yeah. When Steve Harvey says, no, I'm not going to do your show, you know you got a winner.
Yeah, yeah, that's when you got to lean into it. I really wanted to see that LeBron James show.
I have no idea what it is.
It sounds ridiculous. I don't know if it's still on. It was probably on one time and just got canceled, but it was called like...
It's a lip sync rap battle where they have to go through a hole in the wall that comes at you, or you get pushed into whipped cream.
That would be good.
Done.
This LeBron one was awesome, where like apparently like you have to go through a mile like of an obstacle course and you win $1 million. But along the way, at some point, someone starts chasing you. Professional athlete starts chasing you.
That's a metaphor for life. No, that's a metaphor for life, because yeah, you're trying to get that prize, but someone's chasing you down.
Someone who's faster and stronger than you is always right there.
There's obstacles in the way, yeah, of your goal.
That's how Ron overcomes receding hairlines.
That's powerful, yeah. All right, you want to put a really thick sweatband over your receding hairline. All right, that's enough of this nonsense.
Yeah, absolutely.
So okay, what are we at for next week?
We're doing another section. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but it's probably up to around page 302.
Starts at 257.
Yeah.
And ends at, you said 302, so chapter 13?
I think that's right.
All right, sounds good.
I'll put it in the notes, though, for sure. And as always, you can find us at Chad W. Post and open_letter. Brian, you're at BrianWood_.
That's me, yeah.
And everyone should order your book, Joytime Killbox.
Yeah, you've got a couple
BOA editions.
Couple months to save up some money and get it. It's going to be an instant classic that can sell for $1 on Amazon and weeks after its release. So yeah, you don't want to pay that kind of money for it.
If you buy it now at this price, it'll be worth it. It'll be super valuable in like 14
absolutely.
Years.
Absolutely.
You should make an offer. If you buy it, if you're a listener to this show and you pre-order Joytime Killbox from BOA Editions or from your local bookstore and send a picture of your receipt, then Brian will send you a signed book plate to put in your
absolutely. Of course I would.
We'll get those. That's easy enough to do. So anyone who's listening, if you buy it, pre-order, take a picture of the receipt or the whatever proof of purchase, and send it to us.
Yeah, I'll personally sign something and then take a picture and then send the picture and sign the picture, and you could have all of that, all signed and pictured.
All kinds of pictures signed.
Yeah.
And if you buy 10 copies, you can be a special guest on this show.
You'll get a tote bag that's been signed with a picture inside the tote bag that's also been signed.
Of the tote bag picture.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Okay, man. Well, I'll talk to you soon.
All right. Have fun.
Yeah, I will.
Go, Emma. I hope your translation wins. Go.